Welcome to the second tutorial of our series on electric circuits. In our previous tutorial, we started with building the essential foundations of circuits, learning the fundamental terms and concepts related to electricity. In this tutorial, let's shift our focus toward understanding the structure of circuits, starting with the different components that make up a circuit. But if you've missed that first tutorial, I recommend checking it out first. We'll link it in the description below. We're collaborating with Digilent on these, offering affordable test and measurement devices like Discovery 3, which we'll actually use in the examples and testing in this series. So, all right, in circuits, components fall into two main categories, active elements and passive elements. While learning the fundamentals of voltage and current, we typically begin with passive elements for simplicity. Passive elements are those that either store or dissipate energy within a circuit. Active elements like batteries and generators are power suppliers. They can supply power or energy to a circuit from an external source. In other words, they provide that push to move charges through a circuit. Beyond these, there's a world of nonlinear active components like transistors and diodes that play a crucial role in circuits. These elements have a unique ability to control or modulate the flow of electricity, enabling advanced functionalities within circuits. They contribute significantly to signal amplification, regulation, or even signal processing in complex electronic systems. They are very exciting, but a bit more complicated, so we'll leave them for later tutorials. In this tutorial, we will be discussing two essential active circuit components, voltage and current sources. These sources are classified as either dependent or independent. Independent sources, like batteries or generators, maintain a steady voltage or current output regardless of the circuit's condition. These sources don't alter their output based on the surrounding circuit's behavior, making them reliable power providers for various electrical systems. Dependent sources, on the other hand, which essentially generate voltage or current based on another circuit element, are beyond the scope of today's discussion. If you are interested in learning more about them, we have a great overview that is also linked in the description below. So, independent voltage sources, as the name suggests, are circuit elements that maintain a specified voltage across their terminals. They can provide either a constant or time-varying voltage. You might recognize the symbol. In a circuit diagram, a constant voltage source looks like this. Whereas for time-varying voltages, a circle with a sine wave denotes an alternating source, often producing a sinusoidal waveform. However, in most cases, this symbol represents all independent voltage sources and is the go-to symbol for voltage sources simply because it's more generic. In circuit diagrams, these symbols help identify the voltage type being supplied, indicating its polarity without the need for assumptions. However, the current direction isn't specified here and must be determined through circuit analysis or assumed according to the passive sign convention. Let's take a look at an example of how to analyze a circuit diagram with an independent voltage source to understand its polarity. In this circuit, the positive and negative signs tell us the polarity of the voltage source. According to the passive sign convention, current flows from the positive terminal to the negative. So we can assume the direction of current flow to be clockwise from the positive to the negative terminal of the voltage source. Similarly, an independent current source maintains a specific current regardless of voltage differences across its terminals. They can deliver either constant or time-varying current. This symbol is used to represent an independent current source. As you can see, the symbol specifies the direction of current flow, but it does not denote the voltage polarity or direction across its terminals. Determining the polarity, again, requires further circuit analysis or assumptions according to the passive sign convention. In this case, you can see that the direction of current is already specified. According to passive sign convention, current enters the circuit element at the positive terminal. So in the given circuit, voltage polarity across the terminals of the circuit element can be determined based on the direction of current flow. To summarize, there are two primary types of circuit elements: active and passive. Active elements like batteries supply electric energy to the circuit, whereas passive elements like resistors store or dissipate this energy. Our focus so far has been on active circuit elements, specifically independent sources like voltage and current sources. But now let's delve deeper into resistors, a significant passive element, while also exploring the relationship between voltage, current, and resistance. In our previous discussions, we touched upon the concept of resistance in electric circuits. Resistance, measured in ohms, shown as the Greek omega, hinders the flow of electric current in a circuit, causing it to slow down. One important thing to note is that resistance is an inherent property found in nearly all materials. It represents the energy loss incurred when an electrical current passes through a conductive element. When electric charges move through a circuit element, energy is dissipated in the form of heat. Talking about resistance, you may be wondering why resistors are so commonly used in electric circuit diagrams. The resistor, besides being an important passive element, is also used to represent the resistance we encounter in real-world electrical elements. So this is the symbol that you'll often find in circuit diagrams. Resistors help us model and understand how resistance impacts the flow of electrical current within a circuit. This representation allows us to analyze and design circuits by showing how resistance affects current flow and voltage. By using resistors in circuit diagrams, it becomes easier to predict how the circuit will behave based on the resistance encountered at different points. Now, let's talk about a simple yet fundamental law in the world of circuits that describes the relationship between voltage, current, and resistance. Ohm's law. Now, Ohm's law states that the voltage across a conductor or resistor is directly proportional to the current passing through it, given a constant resistance. Mathematically, it is expressed as V equals R times I, where V is voltage, I is current, and R is resistance. You'll often see it as V sub T and I sub T, as expressing voltage and current as a function of time lets us handle scenarios where these electrical quantities can fluctuate due to circuit changes or external factors. In these situations, we need to recognize that V sub T is the voltage across the conductor or resistor, in volts, I sub T is the current flowing through the conductor or resistor, in amps, and R is the resistance of the conductor or resistor, in ohms. I also need to explicitly state that this relationship does not work with power sources, capacitors, or inductors. Frankly, outside of resistors, just assume that this won't apply and you'll be right most of the time. So when we first dive into circuit analysis, we often start with the DC aspect, simplifying things by considering constant or average values of voltage and current. This simplification is especially useful when dealing with real-world applications dominated by constant voltages and currents, like in batteries or power supplies. It is important to note that resistors always dissipate energy. As you can see in this figure, the current enters the resistor from the terminal with the highest voltage potential, following the passive sign convention, and ensures a positive resistance value. This also indicates that resistors always absorb power. Now, here's something interesting. Negative resistance, although rare, is a unique property seen in certain components. Increase the voltage, and you'll witness a decrease in current, which is contrary to Ohm's law, unless you have a negative resistance. It's an anomaly not commonly found in everyday circuits, is mathematically simple, even if you encounter it, and so we just won't worry about it. Now that we've gained insight into various types of active and passive circuit elements, let's use Ohm's law in a few examples. As you can see, this is a simple circuit with two elements, a voltage source supplying 6 volts, and a resistor of 2 ohms. Using Ohm's law, we can solve for the current flowing through the 2 ohm resistor. According to Ohm's law, V equals I times R. Since we know that V equals 6 volts and R equals 2 ohms, we can solve for I and we get the value of I as 3 amps. Let's take a look at another example, this time with a current source. The given circuit has 2 elements, a current source supplying 2 amps, and a resistor of 4 ohms. To find the voltage drop across the 4 ohm resistor, we can use Ohm's law to solve for V. Since we know that I equals 2 amps and R equals 4 ohms, we can solve for V and we find that the voltage across the resistor is 8 volts. Up until now, our focus has been on basic circuits featuring only one circuit element alongside either a voltage or current source. However, while working with circuits having multiple circuit elements or sources, it's important to understand specific terms used to describe certain circuit structures. There are 3 important terms used to describe a circuit: branches, loops, and nodes. Let's begin by understanding what constitutes a circuit element or branch in a circuit. A branch is any element or source in a circuit. This could include common circuit elements like resistors, capacitors, and inductors, as well as voltage or current sources. Stepping back from individual components to view a broader perspective of a typical circuit, let's look into the junctions where these branches connect, referred to as nodes. Nodes, or junctions, form in circuits when components connect to each other or when multiple wires converge. It's a junction that doesn't measurably impede the flow of current. Essentially, nodes represent connection points in the circuit. Let's look at this with an example. In this circuit, there are four nodes. Node A links resistor 1 and resistor 2. Node B connects resistor 2 and resistor 3. Node C joins the voltage source and resistor 3, while node D connects resistor 1 and the voltage source. It is important to note that any points in a circuit that are connected by perfect conductors will be at the same voltage and will thus be part of the same node. To understand this better, let's look at a slightly more complicated example of a circuit with four nodes. As you may observe, this circuit appears to have eight meeting points or junctions, suggesting the presence of eight nodes. However, points 1 and 2 have no circuit elements between them, making them electrically identical, and therefore we consider them as one node. Similarly, points 4, 5, 6, and 7 have no circuit elements in between, share the same voltage potential, and are considered as one node. Have you ever considered what happens when two nodes in a circuit expected to be at different voltages are directly connected? This is a common phenomenon called a short circuit. When two nodes at different voltages accidentally connect, the resistance between them decreases significantly, potentially approaching zero. This sudden drop in resistance occurs because of the direct connection creating a low resistance path. According to Ohm's law, when resistance approaches zero, the equation V equals IR suggests that if there's any finite voltage, the resulting current will increase significantly. Hence, in a short circuit, where the resistance approaches zero, the consequence is an enormous spike in current flow through the circuit. This sudden surge can cause overheating, component damage, and circuit malfunctions, posing serious equipment and safety risks. Another important term to understand in circuit structures is loops. Nodes represent the junctions where elements connect, while loops outline the closed pathways formed by these connected nodes. A loop is a closed path within a circuit that starts and ends at the same node, encompassing various elements such as resistors, sources, and wires. When analyzing a circuit, choosing specific loops helps simplify the analysis. In our previous example of a circuit with four nodes, you can see there are various possible ways to loop through the circuit. For beginners, choosing loops in a circuit can begin with identifying simple closed pathways formed by components. Start small, focusing on key elements like resistors or voltage sources. Practice recognizing single element loops, avoiding overlaps, and gradually advancing by practicing loop identification in various circuits to build confidence and circuit analysis skills. In circuits, components can be arranged in series or parallel configurations, impacting how current flows and how nodes and loops form. Components in series connect one after the other, creating a single pathway for current. This connection involves components sharing a common node where they're linked end to end, with no other components branching off from that shared point. Each element shares the same current, and the total resistance is the sum of individual resistances. In a series arrangement, nodes are where components connect end to end, and there's only one loop that covers the entire circuit. Parallel components, on the other hand, create multiple pathways for current flow. Nodes in parallel setups are where multiple branches converge, and there are multiple loops due to the different current paths. Each element shares the same voltage, and the total resistance is calculated differently than in series, using the reciprocal formula. We'll go more in depth on these calculations later as well. They're not as difficult as you may think at first glance. However, many circuits combine both series and parallel configurations of components. Such hybrid arrangements create complex pathways for current flow. In these circuits, understanding and identifying nodes and loops becomes even more essential for analysis. And there you have it. As we conclude our exploration of circuit structures, we've taken a significant step towards solving real-world circuit problems and delving into practical examples. I want to thank Digilent for their help in supporting the creation of this educational content, whose partnership and support have been indispensable. The best way to support us as we create more educational content is to go check out Digilent at digilent.com and see if any of their tools or other resources can help you become a better engineer. As always, if you'd like to see our written tutorial with more in-depth information, head over to circuitbread.com and check out the detailed blog post linked in the description below. We will be using the concepts we've learned in this tutorial to explore a few more circuit laws in the next tutorial. If you like this video, give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and we will catch you in the next one. Take care. Hey, I hope this tutorial was helpful. Did you know that circuitbread.com also has more useful engineering content? In addition to the tutorials, textbooks, tools, and other things, we have dozens of EE FAQs that explain quick, standalone concepts that are helpful for electrical engineers. Go check them out.